Learning how to tell time, then, is the first step in grasping the mystery of life and death. Yet, time can be an ornery and problematic instrument for defining our world and making meaning. Some of us find ourselves trapped in the past, unable to break the cycle of reliving old injuries or nursing regrets about what might have been. Some of us are equally held bound by the future, as fear or greed or ambition compels us headlong into a time that is not yet ours. There is a truth in the idea that we only own 2 moments of our lives for sure. The present moment and the time of our death. We intercede for both moments when we pray the Hail Mary. Pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. We know that there is a power in those 2 moments alone, and we cannot change the past, and we cannot claim the future. The only active time is the time of decision, which is now. And we believe as Catholics that what we choose orients us in the hour of our death for eternity. Those 2 powerful moments are in our control. The rest of our lives revolves around them like planets fixed in orbit by 2 mighty suns. One critical piece of information we would like to have is not given to us. What is the relationship between those 2 moments? How close is now to the hour of our death? Because of the way we have learned to tell time, we naturally are curious, if fearful, about how that breaks down in time on a calendar or on the face of a clock. We might want to know if the hour of our death is something we should be concerned about soon, or if we can forget about it for a while longer. Father, save me from this hour. We are tempted to overlook that our way of calculating time is an arbitrary measurement, useful only to those locked into time by the fact of our mortality. As Scripture tells us, to God, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is like a day. We see our death as quite distinct from our present hour, but in a larger sense, the 2 are 1 in the eyes of God. Our conception in our mother's womb also contains the seeds of our death, and the life we cling to with such attachment is over like a sigh. And Jesus awaited his hour just as we await ours. But for him, death was the hour of glory, the vindication of human hope, and the demonstration of God's infinite mercy. We're tempted to minimize Jesus' courage. After all, he was fully God and shared a sense of where things were going and what awaited him on the other side of the cross. We play down the fact that Jesus was also fully human, locked into a finite moment of time, facing the even more finite hour of his death, trapped within the same narrow limits of our humanity. He admitted to his disciples that the thought of his impending death troubled him. But he still refused to say, Father, save me from this hour. Such a request would annul the salvific significance of the incarnation. Christmas would be meaningless. The incarnation through which God came to liberate us from the wages of sin was by entering entirely into it. If Jesus did not face his hour with the same unknowing dread that we meet ours, the crucifixion would have seemed like an artful mirage. The author Alice Camille once wrote, "Preserving our lives for eternity does involve temporal surrender. It does mean meeting the hour of our death head on by investing in it through the choices of this hour and every hour. Time is short, but eternity is not. If we did not learn well in our early training that the purpose of our days is to orient ourselves, and there's only one orientation we have, and that is to orient ourselves to the time without end, now is the time to incorporate that lesson. Our only orientation is to time without end.